This was another difficult day in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. The U.S. death toll rose to at least 102, and for millions of people, basic needs became increasingly urgent. Ray Suarez has the story.
4 days after Sandy hit, patience was in short supply. So were gasoline, electricity, and clean water. Again today, car after car after car waited long hours at gas stations in New York and New Jersey.
It's crazy because people is fighting. They jumping in front of each other. They want to get out the car and they want to fight you. So you're going to have to stand in line to get gas or you won't get none.
This afternoon in hard-hit Ocean County, New Jersey, Governor Chris Christie promised help.
We are working with FEMA, and we have lots of the oil companies, Gulf Oil and Hess, have both said that they will deliver gasoline with the National Guard and FEMA to any gas station that's not giving out gas because they're out of gas. So we're on top of the gas situation.
Frustration was also at a boil on New York City's Staten Island, where local officials complained they've been largely ignored since Monday's storm.
This is America. This is not a third world nation. We need food. We need clothing.
There was also an all-day fight over running the New York City Marathon Sunday morning, beginning on Staten Island. New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg initially defended the decision to proceed.
It doesn't use resources that can really make a difference in recovery and that sort of thing. It's a different group of people. We have to work around the clock for people to get through this thing, and I assure you we're doing that. And if I thought it took any resources away from that, we would not do this.
But late today, Bloomberg reversed course and announced the marathon was canceled. Further adding to the frustration of many, the power was still off for well over 3 million customers, many of them in New York and New Jersey. This man lives in Far Rockaway in Queens.
We're not sitting around singing Kumbaya. This is really a dangerous, dangerous situation, and it's a real dangerous place in the dark.
The power company Consolidated Edison said it hopes to have all the lights back on in Manhattan by tomorrow, but others could wait as long as November 11th. New York Governor Andrew Cuomo was unimpressed.
That'll be great for downtown Manhattan. I grew up in a place called Queens, and there's a place called Brooklyn, and there's a place called the Bronx, and a place called Staten Island, and they need their power back on.
You're very welcome.
Food was a pressing need in places like Manhattan's Lower East Side, the Alphabet City neighborhood, where volunteers have been handing out free meals. A local minister said many people are struggling.
They see that other areas are being taken care of, and they totally overlooked us. Now, a couple days later, we're finally getting some resources, and most of the resources that have come in so far have not come from the city. They've come from different organizations, charitable organizations, churches.
Meanwhile, the long job of cleaning up moved forward, slowly.
This is the front of my house.
In Pleasantville, New Jersey, near Atlantic City, uprooted trees littered the landscape, along with homes declared unsafe for human occupancy. Returning residents spent the day picking up the pieces.
This is a house we all grew up in, me and all my cousins, and it was my grandmother actually grew up in this house. It's been in our family for over 120 years. It's withstood every hurricane until this one.
But for all the sudden new difficulties of just getting through the day, some optimism remained.
I don't think that's going to defeat us, this one perfect storm.
And there were more signs of progress. Federal officials waived a rule that blocks foreign oil tankers from bringing fuel to the Northeast.
And for more on how these problems are affecting residents, we turn to Patrick McGeehan, who's been covering the storm for the New York Times. And Patrick, I guess emblematic of what's going on in New York is what you saw in the West Side neighborhood off the Hudson River of Chelsea. Tell us about it.
Well, yes, I was down in Chelsea today where there's power was still out in a building where with no elevator, so you had to walk up six flights to get up and down. And it's still dark around there. It's completely different than it is up here in Midtown, and it's been that way all week. People are mostly getting around on foot. The cabs are having trouble getting enough gasoline. There's one gas station on the west side in Midtown, sort of west of the theater district. And it had a line this morning of cars, mostly taxi cabs, all the way down to the Chelsea neighborhood, about 25 blocks. And it had to represent hours in line, and it seemed to be growing at the time.
Are people frustrated? Is there this sense almost everywhere you go that people somewhere else are getting helped faster than you are?
Yeah, I think the frustration is starting to build. I think people are reaching the outer limit of their patience with being without power, particularly. I think in the suburbs it's particularly bad because people expect to see a truck past their house in their neighborhood with people up working on lines. And when they don't see that, they think they've been neglected and ignored. And so you hear that from Long Island, you hear that from Westchester County. You hear less of that in New York City because people don't really expect to see the repairmen, in front of their building necessarily. And their power will come on all at once, like in neighborhoods and as opposed to out in the suburbs where some people need power restrung right to their house.
Is there a solid waste problem? I mean, with so much damage to so many things in so many places, is there just a lot of reeking, fetid stuff around that doesn't have any place to go yet?
Yeah, there are places where the city is starting to smell. I was in this building today where I was passing on my way up the stairs. I was passing people carrying huge bags of trash down the stairs, trying to get them out of the building. And that building had not had working toilets since Monday. So there are a number of places like that. I was in the Con Edison utility company headquarters, and they've been without power since Monday night. Running on generators, but they don't have their toilets working either. So, or they didn't for much of the time. I think they might be back on now, but it smells bad in some of these buildings, and I guess it's going to continue for another day or two.
Are people getting enough information from local government about what they can expect and when? Do people feel well informed?
I think they do. I mean, those who are able to get it, receiving it is a problem if you don't have power. But there's been no shortage of briefings by the mayor, Governor Cuomo, Governor Christie, utility company executives. They're doing lots of outreach, but most of the news isn't that good if you're without power. So I don't know how much how much it makes people feel better.
Patrick McGeehan from The New York Times, thanks for joining us.
Sure. Thank you.
Hurricane Sandy also devastated parts of the Caribbean, including Haiti, where 54 people died. Special correspondent Fred DeSam-Lazaro filed a dispatch and photos from Port-au-Prince. Those are on our world page.